Greetings everyone and welcome back to 365 Days of Prog. Today we'll be reviewing The Turn of a Friendly Card by the Alan Parsons Project.
Hi, my name's Naomi. I'm an avid progressive rock fan, but I'm a long ways from knowing all the prog albums out there. But this year, I'm gonna give it a try. This is 365 Days of Prog.
Now, let me not bore you with anything else, let's just get right into my favorite bits from this album. So since discovering that Alan Parsons himself was an engineer that worked on the production of The Dark Side of the Moon by Pink Floyd, I was basically pretty stoked to get to know his own personal, you know, albums. So of course I already knew The Eye in the Sky and Sirius, both of them being fantastic, fantastic songs off of him, so I wanted to get to know more. Now we also must remember that this is the Alan Parsons Project, this is not Alan Parsons alone, this is actually him with Eric Wolfe. And they're doing this project together. They're both very, very talented at whatever they do, basically, and the music they created on here together is fantastic. But what we must remember as well is that they're joined by a lot of guest musicians who are very talented and add a lot into the music. Now, this album is an odd breed per se, because it came out in 1980, basically at the start of the 80s, and it isn't really prog, but it isn't really all that 80s music as well, at least as I see it. It kind of falls in a very uncharted territory between the two. But despite its obvious dislocation, this album actually became quite a hit in the masses, and it is debatably the best work released by the project. Now, after all, this series is still 365 Days of Prog, and this album kinda cheats it a bit, because you wouldn't really say this is prog in its nature. It would be better to say that this is crossover prog, although honestly, it's only by definition, because progressiveness isn't really a strong suit of this album. But on the other hand, it depends what you define prog as, because one of the definitions I really like using is actually saying, well, progressive music is music that really aims to be, you know, shifting and changing in order to actually make it more engaging to the listener. Music that breaks the norms in order to be special, but doesn't really, you know, have to be pretentious in any way. It just really has to be more than just simple structures and being more than just regular songwriting and traditional songwriting. And when you look at it like that, I think this album actually does kind of count as prog. But nevertheless, what I'm saying right now, there are a lot of prog purists who object to this album being called prog, and you know what, in all honesty, I don't really care. I'm reviewing it, I enjoyed it quite a bit, and I think I'm pretty glad that it's on the list. And yeah, I guess this is the point where I tell you all that this album really is quite amazing and I loved it quite a bit. It really took me by surprise. I think this album really stands out because of its very, you know, medieval feeling and the very focus on the orchestral arrangements on here. I love instruments like the harpsichord or the brass instruments featured on here, and of course all the guest musicians doing a fine job, each one at their own instrument. While most songs on here do follow some very basic and simple structure, I think while on most days I wouldn't really like that, today at least, and on this album specifically, I love this to bits. Apparently two songs on here were actually quite familiar to me, to the point where I think I know them, but I just don't know from where I know them. Those two, of course, being The Games We Play and Time. Now, of course, it's not The Time that Alan Parsons produced. This is a different song also called time, and I think it's really cool, and it has this really nice psychedelic ambient midsection, which is really unexpected in most, you know, classical traditional 80s music, so that's kind of cool. But when it comes to my favorite, it has to be the title track of Turn of a Friendly Card. Now, this album can actually be divided in two ways. There are those who look at the last few pieces, like the last five pieces, as being one piece, the title track, the title suit, called The Turn of a Friendly Card, and there are some releases which released it as five separate tracks. Now, specifically, I'm gonna look at it as five separate tracks, and specifically, my favorite song from here is the first title track, the part one of The Turn of a Friendly Card. I absolutely love this song. Like, you know, I have a favorite track from each album, and you know, sometimes they're perfect. Yeah, sometimes they're perfect, but most of the times, honestly, they're just the best thing out of the album, but not a perfect song in any way. And of course, I take all of these favorite songs and I put them on my own playlist, but there are agreeably some songs which I much prefer than others. But when it comes to this specific track, it is so, so perfect. And if it makes any sense, I think that the second part of the title track is also perfect, but just not as perfect as the first one, which is perfecter. I love how the music is mostly in minor. I love the heartfelt lyrics on here. I love the way that it deals with the idea, the entire concept of gambling. It's all so good. But honestly, most tracks on here have some sort of, you know, thing that shines on them that I really, really like. So for example, when it comes to singing, I really like the way that Elmer Gandry sings on the first track. I think his vocals are perfect for that specific track, but also Eric Wolfson's vocals on the third track of Time are really, really good. I think that the fourth track has us all, you know, basically blessed with Ian Barnson's guitar on there. I think he plays both the rhythm guitar and the lead guitar, and he does a fantastic job. Really one of the best guitar performances that I've viewed in a while. Presumably it's Mel Collins playing on the saxophone on the fifth track. There is some debate whether it is him or not, and whoever plays the saxophone on the fifth track is doing a fantastic job. And you know, to top it all off, I think that what I really like about this album is the fact that it's very chill in many ways. It's like intense because everything that's put into it is really intense. It doesn't really try and play hard or strong or loud. It is just intense because of the emotions in the lyrics and the playing and the way that the instrumentation goes, and the variety of instruments that appear on here all add up to something which is really chill in its nature, but also very up close and personal to the listener. Honestly, if I had to say, I think that this album isn't perfect because it's not specifically prog as you'd expect prog to be. But looking at it objectively, this album is freaking fantastic. So when talking about covers on this series, there's basically two things that I try and approach. The first one is, of course, my personal opinion about the cover, and the second one is memorability. So I'll start off with the memorability on this one, because I believe this cover to be very, very memorable. The way that it does things right, it takes this one object, which is really synonymous with the entire album by now, and it makes it stick into your mind. Of course, the object itself is the card that is looming. It's a window, basically. It's a crystal window. It makes you think of a church. There's light emanating from it. It's of course the King of Diamonds, which is a strong card, maybe not as an ace, but when it comes to, you know, looking at things aesthetically, I think the king does look kind of better. And this cover just does things right. When looking at it, you really feel the album itself, and specifically the title suit of The Turn of a Friendly Card, because I haven't really focused on it quite a lot, but this one focuses a lot about gambling. The entire idea of the suit is gambling, the addiction and whatever comes with it, and I think that a lot of people see it as like a way of, you know, resorting out of something else, having a lot of problems, then going and gambling and it all comes away, but then it just brings in more problems. And I like the way that this cover really makes it similar to religion in some way. So yeah, overall, I think it's a lovely cover. It's really memorable. It looks great. It has a lot of symbolism, which I won't go into, but in my own humble opinion, this is a perfect cover. So honestly, I don't care what a lot of people have to say. This might be prog, this might not be prog, but whenever it comes down to it, is it good or is it not good? And if you ask me, this album is as close to perfect as you can get, and thus it's receiving a 9 out of 10. But that's about it, guys. I hope that you enjoyed this video and stay tuned for tomorrow because we're gonna be listening to Rock Apollo's Land by Grobschnitt. If you thought that I was just saying curse words in another language, well, you'd be wrong. Although it does kind of sound like it. But that's about it, guys. Have a wonderful day and I'll catch you all tomorrow. Bye, guys.